Good evening, viewers. Another episode of Guest with Nazir. Today, we have personality of the week, Mr. Jangir Awan, a retired army officer, an entrepreneur, and very keen personality in education. Welcome in our show.
Thank you very much, Nazir. Thank you.
Please tell our viewers about your early days and your education.
You're taking me back to my native town, Hafizabad. I was born in 1964 town of Hafizabad, which is part of district Gujranwala, and now itself is a Gujranwala. I got my early education up to grade 10 from Hafizabad, and thereafter I went to government college, Gujranwala. From there, I did my FSC, and after doing my FSC, I joined army in 1985.
So at what age you joined the army?
I was 20 at that time, and in fact, I was very keen to become a doctor. And I had done FSC pre-medical, but Allah has been very kind that He had chosen me to join army. So in 1985, 20 years old, I joined army.
And how long you have to stay in Military Academy Kakul to complete your professional qualifications?
Actually, there are two streams. One is a one-year stream and one is two-year stream. And in a two-year stream, you get to do, first of all, your graduation, and then other part of the training, that is 1 year, is your military training. Actually, in the first year also, the military training continues parallel with the education, but second year is most extensive as far as the military training is concerned, where you are more focused on military exercises, physical training, your tactical capabilities is enhanced, your professional attitude, professional grooming is done so that you can join army and start producing results as a functional part of the military machinery.
So soon after completing your official training, so what rank you get in army?
Yeah, actually, the most of the officers, those who go to army, they get the rank of second lieutenant. And there are few cases where the graduates comes into army, like they are engineers and doctors. They directly become captains. So because they have more professional education and they are specialists, when they join, they are given a better rank.
When a lieutenant comes out of the training, so what role he has to take in the unit? So they have to deal with the officers or with the soldiers. So what are their main daily routines?
It's a very, very interesting part of a second lieutenant's life when he joins an army unit, because it is actually Army is not only an institution. It is like a family to an army officer. When he goes to a particular unit, he becomes part of that unit. Even if he retires, he's still known by the unit he went after passing out from PMA. The duties you have asked me, actually, second lieutenant is responsible to have more interaction with the jawans. So he is encouraged to have more informal interaction with the jawans so that they mix up with each other. He got to learn the problems they are facing, how they live, how he can improve their training, what are the weaknesses. Then he tells these all information to his seniors. And then actually in a unit, lieutenant colonel is the commanding officer where the buck stops. So he is the man, then he takes the decision to run a unit. Actually, he's under supervision, he is under guidance, he continues his training under the command of his lieutenant, captain, major, and then his CO as a lieutenant colonel. So they continue working for each other till the time he is groomed and he is promoted to the rank of lieutenant, and then he becomes captain. So he assumes responsibility after having done his training in that particular rank.
Within the army, they have to continue their professional qualification, like they have to do like MSc or graduation or no?
Interestingly, people think that you have joined army and that's it. Army is an institution where you are required to study even if you become a brigadier or general. You see, a second lieutenant cannot become a lieutenant until unless he has cleared his certain exam, let's call it, as they say, map reading exam. If he doesn't clear, he cannot become a lieutenant. A lieutenant has to clear a lieutenant to captain promotion exam. He cannot become captain. In between, they have to do the basic courses where they are sent to infantry school, armor school, artillery school, where they get their detailed training about their particular arm and service. And after they are done that basics, then that officer is in a position to deliver. Then he is in a position to contribute towards the well-being of their jawans, to the training of their jawans, and then if time comes in case of war. So he is prepared after doing that basic course. So then a captain, he is supposed to do a company commander course. He cannot command a company. You know, there is a section, platoon, company, battalion. So it consists of different people. Section is 10 people. Company is, let's suppose, 100 plus. Regiment is, a battalion is around 750. A brigade is around 3,000, 4,000. So with every rank he progresses, he gets more people under his command.
We'll go back to the academy.
Yeah.
Once the cadet has completed his training, so who decides, so which part of the army you have to go, whether you
Excellent.
Have to go in engineering, infantry, or any other department?
That's a very good question. Actually, I have been instructor in Pakistan Military Academy. After doing my training, I was lucky enough to go back and train those cadets who come to become officers. Mainly, it is the responsibility of their instructor, platoon commander, who decides after having spent 2 years with them. He understands their capability, temperament, their professional standing, their intelligence level. So he understands that this gentleman is fit for infantry, this gentleman is fit for armored corps, this gentleman is fit for ordnance. So actually, the more concern people have is that if a boy is physically fit, he can rough out, he has something in his mind, so they try he should go to infantry. So infantry is an arm which fights on the border.
So which part of the army you joined then?
Oh, I joined infantry. Interestingly, Allah was very kind that I was in the first 10 of my course. 235 plus was the strength of our course. So in the army, anybody who in the training becomes in the first 10, he has the prerogative to join any army, any arm, armored corps, infantry, or whatever, any station of his choice, he can go. So I was in the first 10. So I opted for a great infantry battalion, that is 9 Punjab Regiment. And I joined that regiment. And that was, in fact, my instructor's unit as well, who was my platoon commander. He was from 9 Punjab. So he just discussed with me that you are a sportsman, football, hockey, everything you play. And you are in the first 10 as well. So why don't you join 9 Punjab? So there was no denying when he says that you should go to 9 Punjab. And my desire was also that I wanted to join infantry. So I went to 9 Punjab.
Every officer in his life, they have so many incident or interesting stories to share with friends, or when they write book, they share with their readers. So any incident you want to share during the training, because cadets have a lot of stories to tell.
Yes, you're absolutely right. You know what happened? I just narrated that my instructor and platoon commander, God bless him, Colonel Raja Javed Mujtaba. He was my platoon commander, and still he is like an elder to me. When he asked me to join 9 Punjab, I said, okay, yes, I will join. And after that, there was an exercise. In that exercise, two forces were made, one enemy and one friendly. And on one side, I was responsible for a platoon, and my platoon commander was on other side. He brought a patrol to that my location, my trenches and all that. And he told that patrol leader that I want GC Jahangir Awan to be picked up. So
okay.
You should pick him up, make him prisoner of war, and bring him.
Okay.
And he wanted to see that how I behave when I am caught and they, you know, maltreat me and, you know, I go through a physical challenge. And I didn't know it, that this has been planned. So unfortunately or fortunately, when we were digging the trench, my colleague, now he is Colonel Irfan, we both were in the trench, and I just had some piece of work behind. I told him, you stay here, and I'm just coming. I went for 2 minutes, and in the meanwhile, that patrol came, and they picked him up in my place. They thought I'm there. They picked him up and took him. So when they went back, and they found it is not Jahangir Awan, it is Irfan. So his name is, up till now, he is now retired. He is known as Irfan, prisoner of war, POW. So I was lucky to escape that challenge. So it happens in the army.
So we move forward. So at what age you retired from army?
In fact, army doesn't work on age, mostly. Army works on the years of service. So I had completed around 20 years of service, more than 20 years of service. In fact, I opted at that time to,
to get early retirement.
Say goodbye and get into a field of my choice afterward, relive another life. And then I went into the education field in my hometown. In 2010, I got retirement.
So what qualification you completed once you have finished your army career? I believe you continue your education.
Yeah, I continued. In fact, in the army, those officers, those who are better, those who qualify for staff college, there is an exam, and then you qualify for that course. That is known as Pakistan staff course. And that course is for 1 year. You do that. After that, you get a BA honors degree. And after that, I was lucky to have done 3 masters. During my service, I did masters in international relations from Karachi University, and then masters in business administration, that too from Karachi. And lastly, in 2010, when I was retired, I came to UK and then masters in intelligence and security from Brunel University, West London.
So when you decided that you want to move to become an educationist, so you want to do something for education system in Pakistan, so what challenges you have faced during this?
I tell you, in Pakistan nowadays, the people are very education friendly. Everybody is willing to help you to create an environment where people can get good education. There is a mushroom of intelligence institutions all over Pakistan. People, I don't know, in the western part of the world, people may be thinking that there are no schools in the remote areas. My area is not a very developed area, but I could find every brand of a school in Hafizabad. And one brand was left, that was Lahore Grammar School, so I brought that. So almost everybody has an access to all branded school, as well as to the lower school where they can pay less fee and get almost the same education.
What are your thoughts about, because parallel in Pakistan, different systems are running. One is for the tart school, which is for the poor, then it's for the rich, and then the richest, and then on the top, elite class. How you see that?
You know, this division is there. Your observation is absolutely correct. This division is there. But, it will take little time to have one kind of system for whole society, for all people of my country. At the moment, I feel happy that as long as everybody is going to school, it's okay. Slowly and gradually, when we reach to a level where the people, now we have in fact reached to a level where the young people are fully aware, they understand their rights, they can speak for their rights. Now, with the passage of time, I'm sure they would vouch for a system where the equality prevails. But there's no harm in having better schools as well, as you can see in UK.
Is there any suggestions in the government that they're going to put forward a one system where everybody will be appearing in one kind of exams like we have here, GCSEs, O-levels?
There is a thinking, especially in the, I have a close link with the Punjab government education department. They are fully aware that we need to, have uniform system of education for all. And just let me add, in the Army has also school system that is known as Army Public School and Colleges. In all those, my 20, 22 years of service, my children, wherever we would go, as Army officer moves from one place to another, another to another. So they would go to from Lahore to Chaman, from Chaman to Gwadar, and Gwadar to Karachi. They would find the same system. The Army has streamlined its system. Government is trying. And another thing I would like to share, that now the government is taking steps to control the fees of private institutions.
In like your college or school, do you have any facility for the poor and deserving children who are very good in education but they can't afford? Are you providing something free to them?
I have opened 2 schools. One is a Greenland school in Hafizabad, and other is a franchise of Lahore Grammar School. Myself, and I'm very lucky to have my 2 partners with me. One is, both are from Army. One is Major Khalid Mahmood. He is in Canada. Other is Major Mahmood Nawaz. He is in USA, Washington. We all three sat down one day and we said we want to pay back to our city. We all are from Hafizabad. Which are the best field we can do that? We thought education and medical. This is the two, these are the two fields where we can, you know, invest. We went for education. In the school which I told you, Greenland School, we have about 600 students. And out of 600 students, around 100 plus are free. But those who are orphans and those who are really deserving, open check for them. They can just come, register, and their children should go for the education.
Punjab is very famous for the fertile land because Hafizabad is also very fertilized. So what are the famous crops for our viewers' sake? So if you want to tell us anything special about Hafizabad.
I would take pride in telling that Hafizabad is the biggest rice exporting district of Asia. Kernel basmati rice are very famous in the UK and in almost all parts of the world. That Kernel recently, Kernel Saab, very nice gentleman, he died. On his name, the Kernel Basmati rice were originated from Hafizabad. So one is rice. Then we have excellent wheat crop. All crops are very good. Sugar cane, we have very good sugar cane crop. These three are the main crops of Hafizabad. And rice, everybody loves there.
And any message from your side for our viewers that what you want to say to them?
Because this is basically a UK-based channel, and my country people also listen, I would just like to thank them. Because I have been here, I have spent 14th August function here. Their heart beats with our heart, and their heart beats with Pakistan Army. And let me tell them that Pakistan Army is not going to leave any stone unturned to help assist Pakistan in becoming one of the best nations of the world. And they are doing so. And my message to my foreign brothers and sisters is, do not lose hope. Keep helping and praying for Pakistan, and you will find that Pakistan will not let you down. A time will come, we will stand in line with the most developed nations of the world.
Thank you, Mr. Vaughan, for joining us.
Thank you.
Viewers, I hope you have enjoyed today's episode. And in coming programs, we'll invite more guests with more stories. Keep watching Sheffield Live.